Coming up on this Christmas edition of Hawkeye News. We'll have our final coverage of the Lady Hawk victory as they bring home their third state championship in Red Oak ISD history. Plus, the third annual Had a Toy Run brings joy to many. Also, we open the vaults for another Where Are They Now? In addition, Hawkeye News investigative reporter Mandy Williams takes a look at the cost of drinking and driving and other alcohol-related crimes in hopes of saving some lives this holiday season. And later, we'll share with you some of this year's goofs, bloopers, blunders, and outtakes from behind the scenes of Project Success's Hawkeye News and Shattered Dreams. All coming up next on this Christmas edition of Hawkeye News.
You're watching Hawkeye News with Heather Blackwood and Rachel Selvey. Sports with Brian Walkles. And student life, academic, and special reports with our Hawkeye News team. Hawkeye News, leadership you can depend on.
Again, with candy canes and silver lanes aglow, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Toys in every store, but the prettiest sight to see is the holly that will be on your own front door. A pair of hop-along boots and a pistol that shoots is the wish of Barney and Ben. Dolls will talk and we'll go for a walk is the hope of Janice and Jen. And Mom and Dad can hardly wait for school to start.
Welcome to this Christmas edition of Hawkeye News. I'm Rachel Selvey.
And I'm Ashley Todd, sitting in for Heather Blackwood, who's on assignment.
Ho, ho, ho! Merry Christmas, ladies! Ho, 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 girls. I have two packages here for you. Well, girls, I'd like to spend a lot more time with you, but I got other kids to take care of. Y'all have a Merry Christmas.
Bye. 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 Now for this month's top stories. As you know, the Lady Hawks are state champions and are celebrating the school's third state championship. We would like to add that Lori Burrow and Kelly Fletcher joined tournament MVP Tori Dacus on the state all-tournament team. The high school held a pep rally on November 26th to honor our state champions. Congratulations to the Lady Hawks. We will have more with senior sports anchor Brian Walkles later in sports.
Once again, the Red Oak High School and Junior High Hawks against destructive decisions, inspiring teams with the great support of the student bodies of all schools helped bring in over 250 toys and cash donations that were turned over to Red Oak Area Outreach. The donations were delivered to the outreach and were distributed to needy families in the Red Oak area. Had It Toy Run chairperson Rachel Wolf wanted to thank all the students and businesses who offered their support of this event. Smiles will be seen on the faces who may have had nothing to smile about if it weren't for you, the students of ROISD.
Without the Had It children, kids, doing this, we wouldn't have enough toys. Last year, we had enough toys not only to fill 326 children's wish list, but we were also able to give to the Salvation Army in Waxahachie the remaining toys to help the children in Waxahachie and in Ferris.
Thanks for giving to others in the true spirit of Christmas. The $250 cash award will be presented to the winning class sponsor after we return from the Christmas break. From Had It for bringing in the most donations. Rachel and her helpers should be commended for this great event.
Football, basketball, volleyball. What do all these have in common? The cheerleaders. Those who keep the fans excited while the team is ahead or behind. We go to Christian Henson for the special inside look at what it takes to keep the spirits high.
Thanks, Rachel. Cheerleading has always been a top sport at Red Oak High School. Some of you may remember us winning the championship title last year. For those of you who don't know how the world of cheerleading works, here's a sneak peek. It all started at camp where the junior varsity and freshman teams won best in their division, and the varsity won many superior ribbons. Practices continued on through the summer all the way up until school started. Afterwards, it took many before and after school practices and hard work to make routines and practice for pep rallies, games, and other school events.
The practices helped us out a lot. They helped us improve on our stunts and our cheers, and it just brought us together more as a squad.
Yes, I think our team works well together because we've grown to love each other and respect each other. And I think that that's grown a good unity as a squad, and we just respect each other. And when you put 36 girls together, of course, you're going to have a couple of problems, and we had our ups and downs at first, but we've grown to love each other.
To become a cheerleader, you must try out in the spring for the following year. Learn to dance, cheer, and chant in 3 days. If you become a cheerleader, you must pass every class and have no bad disciplinary marks. The cheerleaders also volunteer. This year, the cheerleaders have adopted the Red Oak Rehabilitation Center for the Adopt-A-Grandparent program. Cheerleading is not a one-person sport. It's a team effort, and it takes everyone working together to make a difference.
The girls work better together than we did last year. The varsity seems to have brought the junior varsity in a little bit better, and there's a little bit of better unity.
As you can see, it takes a lot to be a cheerleader. They work all year round with no off-season, so when you hear them cheer and tell it to yell, go for it, because you know just what it takes to keep the spirit high. Reporting from Red Oak High School, I'm Christian Henson. Back to you in the studio, and have a Merry Christmas.
Thanks, Christian. What would our fans and athletes do without the cheerleaders? It's great that we here at Red Oak High School will never have to find out.
Next, we take a look at a man whose love for restoring Volkswagens, coaching high school and college soccer, all make up Austin Guest, who is this month's Where Are They Now? Mr. Austin Guest graduated from Red Oak High School in 1985. Mr. Guest was involved in several organizations while attending Red Oak High School. Soccer, track, cross country, National Honor Society, journalism, and whiz quiz. He was also valedictorian, regional qualifier for cross country, UIL literary team's district champ, regional champ, and state qualifier for news writing and soccer captain. Now with his wife Dee Dee and children Gabriella, age 8, and Beckham, who is 2.5, Coach Guest went to college at TCU and restored Volkswagens before going into teaching and coaching.
When I got out of college, I kind of got lured into the family business as I was playing soccer. I was playing in what amounted to a D3 pro league where you don't really make enough money to earn a living. You just make a little bit of money and you have to have a real job on top of that. So I was doing that business with him, and as time went on, and I figured out I wanted to do something different with my life and that I wasn't going to be a full-time soccer player forever, then I moved into teaching and coaching.
His most memorable moment at ROHS was forming the soccer team and his time spent in journalism.
Well, it's been a lot of fun. It started out, I didn't really know what to expect. I wanted to get into teaching. I'd been doing something else, kind of happened into a position here. It worked out great for me. Got to start coaching soccer within a couple of years of that, and it's been a super experience.
From student to teacher, Austin Guest has made his home at Red Oak High School, and many of his students and players are proud he has chosen to stay right here at home.
This month's District in 60 Seconds is brought to you by Brookshire's Food Store, your hometown grocery store.
Christmas cheer, t-shirt winners, and much more top our look at this month's District in 60 Seconds. Red Oak Elementary kindergarten classes have Giving Thanks Lunch. In the spirit of Thanksgiving, the kindergarten classes at Red Oak Elementary took part in a lunch and special ceremony on the importance of giving thanks before the holiday.
Project Success announces t-shirt winners. Fifth graders Skylar Chastain and Tanner Milkey have designed the official t-shirt for the Project Success Drug Education Program. Each fifth grader who signs a drug-free contract will receive a free shirt with the winning design on it. Red Oak High School Choir brings in sounds of the season. The awesome Red Oak High School Choir held its annual Christmas concert at First Baptist Church. Everyone in attendance enjoyed the wonderful performance. Education Foundation held kickoff dinner. The Red Oak Education Foundation held its inaugural kickoff dinner last month at the Waxahachie Civic Center. The event helped raise money for the foundation, and members of Haddett and Red Oak High School Student Council helped out by serving food at the event. More details from the Education Foundation to come in future editions of Hawkeye News. Mentor Program held Christmas party. The Red Oak High School Mentor Program, sponsored by Project Success, held its first ever mentor Christmas party for mentors and their buddies at the Acorn Academy Gym on December 14th. All in attendance had a great time. And that's your district in 60 seconds. And now for a look at what's to come in the new year, here's Heather Blackwood.
Season's greetings, Red Oak High School. Red Oak is growing, and wow, even a new traffic signal at 342 and Louise Ritter Boulevard. What are other plans for traffic signals, and how will this affect students' drive to school in the future? We'll have more on this story in future editions. We are also taking a deeper look into Red Oak ISD's new Plato Lab, and we'll go in search of answers of how this program will help Red Oak ISD students who need credit recovery. We will also bring you much more student information stories that will help students in areas of academics, as well as bringing the spotlight stories on different organizations our underclassmen may be interested in next year. Hawkeye News and Alan J. Oliver are also proud to announce that Hawkeye News will be producing a senior class yearbook video for the class of 2003. The video will be sold by pre-order in coming weeks and will cost $30. The videos will cover all sponsored senior events as well as other events from the 2002-03 school year. You'll hear more on the videos in later editions of our show. We look forward to a great second semester, and we here at Hawkeye News would like to thank the teachers and administrators who have been so much help this year. Until next month, happy holidays. I'm Heather Blackwood. Back to you, Rachel and Ashley.
Christmas and New Year's. What should be some of the happiest days of the year for us all many times becomes a time of tragedy.
It will never happen to me. Famous last words of many who have died as a result of drinking and driving. This month, our own Mandy Williams takes a look at the cost of drinking and driving and other alcohol-related crimes. Mandy?
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Words we often hear around this time of year. But what about, I'm sorry about your loss. I can't believe he or she is gone. Unfortunately, these are also words heard during the holiday season. Words said to those who have lost family members to drunk drivers.
From the Mothers Against Drunk Drivers website, we find that during the Christmas holiday season in 2001, from 6 p.m. on December 21st through 6 a.m. on December 26th, 281 people died in alcohol-related traffic accidents in the United States. New Year's Eve and New Year's Day, 35 more people were killed in drunk driving accidents. Those numbers, multiplied by many family and friends whose lives are also destroyed by drunk driving, makes this holiday season the most deadly and painful time of year. The statistics are staggering, and even with all the public service announcements, higher DWI enforcement, and educational efforts, the number just continues to grow. In the same time period in 2000, 305 died. Yes, over 1,000 lives lost in the past 4 years because someone felt they had the right to drink and drive a car. Texas topped the list of DWI deaths in 2001 with 1,789. Again, we would never try to tell our students what to do, but we owe our fellow students this look at reality. Think of a Christmas morning without one of your loved ones taken by a drunk driver. Think of a child waking up with no mother or father who may have been killed by a drunk driver. What if the drunk driver was you? Texas state law is clear. 0.08 is the legal limit for DWI for those 21 and over. But any trace of alcohol, the slightest smell is enough for a person under 21 to be arrested for DUI, loss of driver's license, and a criminal record. Think before you ruin yours or someone else's lives. Please don't drink and drive at any age. And if you're under 21, don't drink at all. It's the law. Reporting for Hawkeye News, I'm Mandy Williams. Happy holidays.
Thanks, Mandy, for another frightening but informative report. We hope ROHS students listen and take note.
Do you remember your favorite Christmas gift? For some, maybe a bike, a doll, or another childhood gift. For some, maybe it was a new car or another big ticket item.
My favorite Christmas present of all time was when Santa Claus dropped a trampoline in our backyard.
And my favorite Christmas present of all times was when I was 7 years old and I got my first bike. And my dad took me out and taught me how to ride it. Took me a little while to get successful at it, but I finally did. And it was a wonderful Christmas. We had had a sad year because my older sister had died, and they made it a very, very special Christmas for me.
All right, my favorite Christmas present of all time was when I got my bicycle when I was 8.
All right, my favorite Christmas gift was a four-wheeler.
All right, my favorite Christmas gift was a new house.
My favorite Christmas gift is a cruise.
My favorite Christmas gift of all time was being able to see my dad in Ohio.
A few years ago, my wife got me an autographed picture of Walter Payton. He was my hero growing up, and so she rode up to Chicago, and he sent me one, and that's one of my favorite gifts.
My favorite Christmas present is my Malibu Barbie.
The best Christmas I had was when my children were little and I was recently divorced and I was really low on money and I was robbed on December 15th. And all my friends got together and they collected money and I received about $300. And then I started getting checks in the mail or, you know, cash and Christmas cards. I ended up with about $200 or $300 more. So all my special friends and people I worked with really helped me that Christmas, and it made a special Christmas for my children and I.
My favorite Christmas present of all time was my little dog, our little rescue Skipper Key that we got several Christmases ago, our first rescue dog, Noelle. And she was the best gift my husband and I ever received.
My favorite Christmas present of all time was when my wife gave me a little Danbury Mint replica of Michigan Stadium, which I have in my office right now.
My favorite Christmas present of all times was my first Barbie doll. It was the first year Barbie dolls were made, and I got one finally after begging forever. So that was my favorite.
My favorite Christmas present was a football that my parents gave me when I was four. They put it under the tree and did not bother to put it in a box, but just wrapped it up so that it was football shaped. And I still have it to this day and still play with it.
My favorite Christmas present is a puppy that I got when I was little.
My favorite Christmas present is money. That's the best thing. Ain't want no clothes. Money.
My favorite Christmas present of all time would be my car.
My favorite Christmas present of all time is just money. No clothes, no presents, just money, and I'll take care of it. So send money.
My favorite Christmas present was when my children received a Simon for Christmas and I got to play with it.
My favorite Christmas present when I was little was my Weeble Wobble set.
My favorite Christmas present of all time is being with my family.
My favorite Christmas present of all time is my pink Barbie convertible.
My favorite Christmas present was an easy bake oven because I like to eat.
My favorite Christmas present was when I was in third grade and my parents got me a huge Gumby doll that was bigger than me.
My favorite present of all time was a Dell computer we got from my family.
My favorite Christmas present was in the eighth grade I received an alto saxophone from my parents. Never in a million years did I think I would receive a gift that wonderful. It was a terrific surprise.
My favorite Christmas present that I ever got was my size Barbie.
My favorite Christmas present of all time was my Nintendo.
My favorite Christmas present of all time was the A2000 baseball glove that my dad gave me.
My favorite Christmas present of all time was my rocking horse.
My favorite Christmas present was my Barbie doll house.
When I was probably, I want to say like 9 or 10, I got this gift. It was, I think, called Hands Up Harry or Hands Down Harry or something. It was a Western character that was dressed up in the chaps and the holster and the whole works, and it came with a little gun that shot darts with the suction cups on the end. And the idea was, you know, you shot it and he lost his outfit. You know, the holster would fall down, the hands would shoot up, but if you were a really good shot, you nailed him and his pants would fall down. And that was one of the things I certainly remember about my childhood gifts.
The answer is, as you heard, from the small to the tall. But the best gift we have is living in a free country where we can celebrate Christmas all in our own way. Now it's time for sports with our senior sports anchor, Brian Walkles. Brian?
Today we have a final wrap-up of all of our fall sports, including volleyball, golf, and cross-country, and a preview of basketball season. All this and more after a word from our sponsor.
In here, you're bound to find something especially for you. Especially for You offers custom embroidery on many items. Bring in your own items for customizing or purchase items that are in stock. Our team will add a name or graphic to your item. For those demanding even more personalization, digitizing is also available. Our services include embroidery, digitizing, screen printing, promotional products, gifts, custom-made jewelry, and much more. We try to listen to the needs and wants of our customers and deliver that service. For instance, we will be creating football mums and senior overalls this year because our customers have asked for those items. Customer service is most important to us. Our customers are all greeted with a smile and assisted by trained personnel. We try to meet the needs of our customers as quickly and pleasantly as possible. We also take pride in our work, and it shows in how each order is handled. Our staff expertly trims, presses, and packs each order, double-checking it for quality workmanship. Especially For You supports Project Success and is the official clothing supplier of Hawkeye News. Especially For You is located at 133 West Ovilla in Glen Heights. Or for more information, call Leanne Coons at 972-230-7878. This month's Hawkeye News Sports is brought to you by State Farm, Danny Humphreys.
Welcome back, Hawks sports fans. Let's talk sports. In a follow-up to our special report, Lady Hawks State Champions, brought to you last month by Brady Sapp, we'd like to add that Lori Burrow and Kelly Fletcher joined tournament MVP Tori Dakis on the state all-tournament team. The school held a pep rally on November 26th to honor our state champions, and once again, we here at Hawkeye News would like to congratulate the coaches and players for their wonderful championship season. We look forward to covering the ladies in 2003 as they defend their state title. In golf news, the Hawks are underway with their season play under the direction of Coach Steve Williams. The Varsity Hawks competed in their first tournament of the season at the Waxahachie Country Club recently in cool, sunny, and windy conditions. The Hawks competed against some of the top teams in the area and came away with a productive tournament. The Varsity was led by Ryan Griggs, who shot 82 and 76 in the two-day tournament. Others on the Varsity squad were Eric Shutman with an 88-81, Adam Thompson 90-83, Jordan Matoyer, 92, and great second-day score of 78, along with Randy Hinkle with a 92 and 89. The JV and freshman teams also competed, and freshman Michael Myers shot a personal best of 86. Others competing for the JV were John Beckley, Vincent Matthews, Zachary Mosby, Tyler Corey, and Chris Lamb. The freshmen were Myers, along with Ryan Dillon, Gary Goldman, Brady Davidson, and Matt Curry. The golf program has many underclassmen on all levels of play, and should only get stronger in this season and in seasons to come. We'll bring continued coverage of future tournaments in the coming months. The varsity boys and girls basketball season is well underway, and Coach Harner and Coach Foster have seen great improvements in the teams thus far. The boys started their season with a 68-55 win over Burleson. Guy Fernandez led the Hawks with 17 points, followed by Casey Fitzgerald with 16 and Donald Haney with 10. Also scoring for the Hawks were Bill Caldwell, Corey Houston, Josh Cook, Dominic Pryor, Brent Osborne, and Rich Suter. The second game would be a 63-47 pounding of Richardson J.J. Pierce High School at Pierce. Guy Fernandez once again led the Hawks with 25 points, followed again by Casey Fitzgerald with 13 and Dominic Pryor with 10. Others getting in on the scoring action were Corey Houston, Zach Walker, Josh Cook, Donald Haney, and Rich Suter. As they did in the first game, the Hawks shot 50% from the field and grabbed 44 rebounds. After pounding Pierce, the Hawks would stay on the road for a battle with Mesquite Poteet. The Hawks started slow, scoring only 6 points in the first period, but played outstanding defense and held Poteet to only 8. The second period would belong to the Hawks behind the scoring of Guy Fernandez, who had 13 points on the night, and Josh Cook, who added 8. The Hawks would hold at 21-17, led at half in this defensive battle. The fourth period was all about who wanted it more, and the Hawks would go on to show it was them as they completed the victory, outscoring the Pirates 16-9, in the fourth period, taking the game 45-39. Our Hawks would then travel to Athens for the team's fourth game. With a perfect 3-0 start, the Hawks would once again put their unbeaten record on the line. This game turned out to be a battle to the end. The Hawks would fall behind early once again, trailing Athens 16-10 at the end of one period of play. Athens showed no signs of weakening as they again outscored the Hawks 17-15 in the second, taking the score to 33-25 at the half. Once again, super Guy Fernandez came to life and hit a season-high 30 points with 15 of those coming from behind the three-point line, and pulled the Hawks even with Athens at the end of regulation. In the overtime period, the Hawks would take it to Athens, outscoring them 15-9 and winning the game 67-61. Casey Fitzgerald also had an outstanding game, scoring 21 points. The next game would match the Hawks up against our neighbors from the east, the Ferris Yellow Jackets. The Hawks shot out of the gate at fire, outscoring the Jackets 24-9 in the first period. The teams would play the second period even, both scoring 14, and the Hawks went into the locker room at half with a 38-23 lead. Ferris would sting back in the third period, but once again on the hot hand of Guy Fernandez and his 24 points, along with Casey Fitzgerald's 22, the Hawks would take down Ferris by the final score of 67-52. Bill Caldwell, Dominic Pryor, Darius Gray, Donald Haney, Corey Houston, Brant Osborne, Zach Walker also tallied points for the Hawks. Dominic Pryor played strong defense and pulled down several important rebounds. The Hawks would once again have to gear up for a back-to-back game when the Denton Broncos came calling the day after Ferris. The Hawks would once again follow the lead of Area 4A's 10 leading scorer, Guy Fernandez, who mounted another 23-point effort against Denton. The Hawks used the strong inside presence of Dominic Pryor, who scored 10 points, and the outside shooting of Casey Fitzgerald, who added 19 to keep the Broncos down all night. The Hawks, as they have done a few times this season, trailed at the end of one period 22-20, but unloaded on Denton in the second period, outscoring the visitors 24-8 in the frame. The Hawks, behind strong defensive players like Casey Fitzgerald, Dominic Pryor, Josh Cook, Zach Walker, and Corey Houston, held back the Broncos' bid for a comeback and drove the Hawks' record to an impressive 6-0 start, with the final score reading Hawks 78, Broncos 68. The Hawks shot an impressive 61% from the field. The win moved the Hawks to the best start in recent school history with a perfect 7-0 record. After playing in the Maybank Tournament, the JV and Varsity Hawks will return home to take on the WT White Longhorns. Results of the tournament games as well as the WT White game, much more will be shown in the January edition of Hawkeye News. On the girls' side, throws have been a little tougher as the ladies are off to a slow start. With the addition of some new faces coming out of the conclusion of volleyball season, the ladies should only get better as they approach district play. The girls open up their season with a very tough loss to a strong Granbury team. The second game for the ladies was also disappointing as they fell to Fayetteville by the score of 52-30. Once again, the ladies played tough behind the strong inside game of Hollyboro and Deanna Smith. Robin Sterick also showed a strong defensive presence on the floor to the Lady Hawks. The next contest would be before the home crowd as the ladies took on Crowley. The first period was low scoring as both teams had trouble finding the basket, and at the end of one period the score read Crowley 5, Red Oak 2. The second period would prove to be the highest scoring as both teams pounded away. Embry Gregory led the Lady Hawks with 14 points in the night. Ryan Ford also added 10 points in a halftime Crowley led 28-23. Third period, the Lady Hawks would make their move, outscoring Crowley 16-4 in the period and taking the lead going into the final period. With the game in what looked to be control, the Lady Hawks continued to play hard, but as the final buzzer would sound, a questionable foul would be called, and Crowley would hit the free throws to tie the game. In overtime, both teams played strong defense again, and Crowley would take the victory 53-50. Others in on the scoring were Megan DeFrance, who had 8, Brianna Pace with 7, Robin Sterick 7, and Holly Burrell 4. The ladies' next opponent would be the Lady Hoopsters from Cleburne. Cleburne is picked as one of the top teams in the area and showed us why as they defeated the Lady Hawks by a score of 71-37. The Lady Hawks were led in scoring by Deanna Smith, who had 9 points and 13 rebounds, followed by Brianna Pace, who had 8 points. The ladies would continue their on-the-road streak as they traveled to Grand Prairie to take on the Lady Gophers. The ladies fought hard all night behind the leadership of Deanna Smith and fellow high scorer Amy Hafner, who is making her presence known after completing her time with the state champion volleyball team. Hafner and Smith both poured in 14 points as ladies fell behind the final score of 56-43. We'll bring you much more girls basketball action, including results of the Crandall, Boswell, and Waxahachie tournaments, and much more in January. In a final look back at the cross-country season, it's easy to see that this will go down as one of the best, if not the best, in Red Oak High School history. The varsity and JV boys teams both won district this year and qualified for the regional meet as well. The varsity boys on a muddy and cold morning at the regional meet at Arlington's Vandergriff Park did a great job, coming in 16th place overall. Zach Walker, who was first in district, once again led the team, finishing 51st place out of over 175 runners in a time of 17:41. Farron Hansen also finished strong in the top 100. Congratulations to all our cross-country athletes on a school record-setting season. Special congratulations to our district champions, JV and varsity boys teams. Speaking of cross-country, we'd like to welcome Coach Foster and two of the district champion runners, Dennis Jameson and Zach Walker.
Now, Coach, how do you see cross-country next year with returning runners and the loss of this year's seniors?
I think next year is going to be another good year. You know, we had a good, solid group of seniors that gave us some stability, some guys that have been around for a while. But we also had a lot of good young runners. You know, Zach was just a sophomore, and he was the district champ. So we have a lot of good runners coming back, a lot of young runners coming back, and hopefully we can get some more young kids to come in and help replace a lot of those seniors that we're going to be losing this year.
Now, Zach, first of all, congratulations on winning the district championship individually. But what do you attribute the strong season in cross country to this year?
Like I said, we had a bunch of good runners that came out, and everybody showed up and wanted to run, and everybody stepped up when we had to run and didn't slack off.
Now, Dennis, this being your senior year, what memories will you take with you from this year's season?
Oh, well, the friendships that you build when you're running with these guys. Different runs we took. We ran to Sonic one Saturday, and ate up there, and that was pretty cool. And then just hanging out and talking to the guys when you're running, it's real fun.
All right, thanks for coming to the studio today. That's it for sports this month. Hawkeye News will bring you more exciting sports action in the new year.
Thanks, Brian. Have you ever tried to sit in front of a video camera and read? Or have you ever tried to think of an answer to a question on camera and freeze? What about just say the wrong thing and think, why did I do that? Well, if you have, you'd fit in great with this segment. We at Hawkeye News and past cast of Shadow Dreams welcome you to our nightmare of bloopers and outtakes. Producer Alan J. Oliver shows you the goofs, blunders, and laughs in this segment, sure to give a laugh or two. Thank ROISD for giving. Is that it? The preliminary results are in, and Red Oak High School has once again taken great strides on the Texas Assessment of Academic Skills testing. Oh my gosh, that's long sentence.
For more on the Field House, we go to Hawkeye News sports reporter Brady Sapp, who's standing by on the new facility. It's time for sports with senior sports anchor Brian Walkles. Brian?
Well, Heather, it's crunch time in sports. As we near the end of volleyball season, the Hutt late in the middle clock.
I had to cough all of a sudden.
I'm starving. We'll have the full meal deal later in the show.
The answers, as you heard, were from some of the...
I've seen him overcome the odds firsthand, and I know...
We thank those of you who have sponsored us in the past. And we would like to welcome those of you who would like to...
Did you know that graffiti on school property can range from... You've got to be kidding me!
The leading cause of death and disease in this country... Oh, crap. I messed up.
Yes. Reindeer Manor is one of the best fun...
Maybank donated their contributions, right? That home. Maybank donated their contributions to the Veterans Memorial Fund.
They didn't donate.
They donated. Sweet. Swass. Whoa.
The school board is able to...
And we welcome those of you who would like to join us with this very worthy cause. That's not what it said.
Okay. Did you know that graffiti... graffiti...
All hatted activities are open to all the...
On state accountability ratings. Skate.
Reindeer Manor is a real abandoned turn of the century haunted house with a tragic history.
I've got two packages for you ladies here. I'm going to bring over here and put in front of the... You really sound like Boom Higher. I'll show you one way.
You said, oh, he's such a nice guy.
As a donor of your...
Do you know that graffiti on school property can rain? I can't get past the graffiti.
Now, for more on how the new district will affect Red Oak High School and the areas of sports, we go to Hawkeye News sports anchor Brian Walkles. Brian?
Heather and Rachel, the new UIL district finds the Hawks out of one district right into another.
Reindeer Manor is a real abandoned turn of the century.
Happy Halloween.
What is...
Oh my goodness.
Trick or treat,
Mom.
That's about it, guys.
Thanks, Brian.
Throw it.
Okay.
We had a chance to catch up with Buddy Groom at the ballpark in Arlington to ask a few words about what he had to say about graduating from Red Oak High School.
Now, for more on how the district will affect Red Oak High School in the areas of sports, we go to Hawkeye News sports anchor Brian Wackles. Brian?
Heather and Rachel.
The school board was able to tour the facilities last month, Quintecada last month.
It's time for sports with senior sports anchor Brian Wackles. Brian?
Well, Heather, it's crunch time in sports. And that's the end of the conversation.
That's it for this edition. Join us again in January for our first show of 2003. If you'd like to contact us with your news ideas, comments, or suggestions, you can email us at hawkeyenews@redoakisd.org, or you can call us at 972-617-4312, mailbox number 4. From all of us here at Project Success and Hawkeye News,
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year!